you know, but not really got to all of that. So hopefully that makes a difference for you guys. Information. Sorry, I'm stressed. So we just got the last little bit to use. So this might be a good time to like pause. If you don't like need a bathroom break or something. But we're gonna go ahead and do the last chapter. My husband's looking at me like, I'll do what I go to bed. But we still have one more chapter for me to go over. Sorry. But I have a very thorough understanding of the domestic policy. On the foreign policy, hopefully it should go a lot quicker. It'll go quicker. So hopefully you had a chance to go to the bathroom, get back to your computer, or get water or whatnot, which I would love my husband forever if he actually got this out. So I'm sorry. So we'll see. Your domestic policy. I'm very into the book. Yay! Done it 4 months later. So we're just gonna wrap it up with more international policy, which we touched on a little bit, but we haven't really delved into very much. So it's definitely important to go over for sure. So okay. Make sure that it's showing up at the right thing.
Okay. All right, so foreign policy. America's foreign policy can have profound effects on the lives of individuals here abroad. President Trump's decision to ban immigration from certain countries, like many lives in limbo, like that of Muhammad Ali, pictured here. Ali was reunited with his family after being stranded in Kenya when the ban was declared. The borders of the ban maintain its necessary to protect immigrants. And that is a continual back and forth that we definitely have as a debate in this country as to how many people we let in every year from what countries, from what sort of more foreign countries, from turmoil that's happening in places abroad. And there's never a full consensus. And it really depends on about those countries and your feelings on like how much you should be on international level. So like how much about diplomacy versus other things. And so a right or wrong answer is subjective, right? Like what I consider the right answer is not so. So it's really hard for elected officials, I think, to find that happy medium to help people who truly need it without putting putting us at risk in other ways, especially with the pandemic and things like that. Like, that has made it even trickier about how open our borders are or not, and that kind of thing. So the definition of foreign policy is pretty broad, right? But it includes programs and policies that determine our relations with other nations and other foreign entities. And basically, the level of that varies from presidential administration to administration. So it includes diplomacy, military and security, international human rights, trade policy, international energy policy. You're going to see that again on Tuesday as well. So make sure that you remember our different policies and specifically you're gonna want to know what our goals are, which are right here. So this slide will go for you. That will help a lot. Security, right, keeping us safe, keeping our borders safe from economic prosperity, which means international trade, buying our goods, and buying other people's goods, and take human rights on an international level, and when do we step in, right? Like, when do we help? Where do we help? How much impact on ourselves? World War II, we were very much an isolationist country. Something that George Washington had encouraged in his farewell speech, and a lot of artificial founders were like, let everybody else be aware of this problem because they, it's around from the way it's gone. And so I think you're looking at it through a different set of glasses, right, than others. Unfortunately, by being isolationists, we became innovating targets during World War II. If you remember, like, it's not stepping in sooner, we could literally squash that whole thing, and Hitler may have not gotten as far and done as much, have seconds here. And then we became targets. And so we realized that, okay, we are a global scale, we're all connected on a level. Was the case during Washington and Alexander Hamilton. And so these sort of rules don't apply anymore. And so we kind of shifted that. So the first step for our foreign policy to be effective, we've got to make sure that we're safe as best as we can, and that we are paying attention to possible foreign hostile dangers. Between what they call nation states, which are other nations, other entities. Another big concern we have, especially today, the public terror experts, are what they call non-state actors. They're groups other than other nations that attempt to play a role in the international system. Terrorist groups are one type of non-state actors. So it's taking groups and individuals who they don't represent like a country, state, nation state. Like there are some places that consider like a state, not like a whole nation. So like we have a possible threats like that. But here lately, our larger threats have been like these groups that don't represent an entire nation. With 9/11, or like Iraq and Afghanistan didn't attack us. That was a specific group of terrorists. They were non-state actors. It wasn't the countries that attacked us. It was extremists from those countries. Just like the entirety of Japan didn't attack us, right? Like, certain grade. Kind of, but like not everyone consists of how you think of that. So, anyways, it's a whole different situation. So that's something that we focus a lot on, that we make sure that we have a strong military to protect protect from last week and so we rely a lot on our military, on making sure that we're strong as a whole. Gather information about potential attacks, potential dangers. CIA does a lot of that. This is why I'm not for people all the time. Our mixed feelings are on one another. We serve to do that, but you know, we're in a lot of ways by doing that, by guiding out intelligence. But a lot of people, obviously, especially in other countries, have problems with that. Because they feel like we're maybe crossing the line, but most other countries, especially first world countries who have the means and the technology and the education to do so,
do the same thing.
Like they have their own kind of version of that, right? And then we share that information with our allies that help protect each other. A lot of alliances that are formed to try and prevent things like cyberspace is something that has been sort of a threat that they're trying to figure out the best way to manage, because you've got these sort of dark websites where people are talking about acts of violence and people are being recruited into the Taliban and things like that, and it'll sort of these like underground dark web things that we're having to. So all of that has been a huge struggle, not just for us, but for other countries as well. I mean, there have been other terrorist attacks that have been bombings, you know, in London, and it's something that people are dealing with across the globe. They don't just hate us,
they hate us and everybody else.
So everybody is
not like them, right?
So I mentioned the isolationism before. So we definitely focus on a lot of James Monroe and Washington Bell advocating for that. They're not just
Pearl Harbor basically severed that.
Isolationism in general. Avoidance of involvement in the affairs of other nations. Some people still argue for that, but it's really almost impossible to effectively.
We have the
global economy we have. You can't say, well, how do trade together for 6 years, but we're in trouble and we're going to call it. That's the friendship, right? Like, you're not being good friends. And if, like, we would expect people to, like, have this view, but we were attacked by some crazy outlying country, like, or if they're trying to decide to like jump on us, we would hope that like all of Europe and other places and like Canada, Mexico, and everywhere else would be like, oh, no, we're not going to have all that. Like, we need to
hope.
So, in turn, like, we had agreements to like other people. So, we definitely learned that isolationism is not but it's just not effective or policy anymore. So World War II definitely ended isolationism and ushered in what we know now as containment, which is the policy design of political expansion. Basically, like knock them off at the knees, like don't let them like get too far, right? So after World War II. After what happened, so some people wanted things to be even more aggressive than that. Like stand up and be like, okay, they'll start that more. We have,
right?
Like that's kind of containment, right? Like, I will start by that, I will finish it. But some people feel like something like a preventative war
is even more effective. Maybe on the offensive or against a policy,
striking first when a nation fears that war is possibly hostile action. So the issue with that concept is the same.
Why the Supreme Court doesn't hear
special cases of,
well, this issue could happen without a
Congress. Same way that Congress doesn't grant an impact on a law because something may happen, because you can't go around beating everybody because they might look at you sideways.
Right?
We all learned that in elementary school.
Like,
if you do that, you become a bully. You get trouble. You get your butt lit when you go home. Right? Like, aggressor in a situation all because somebody may or may not be inside out or say something else wrong. Like, yes, we fight for it all day. And, like, even though that's a much simpler version of this, like, we can't always fight first. Now, that's not to say that maybe not the word war, but not to say that we have not taken preventative actions when you get certain information, like the CIA has gotten intelligence information from all their little spy games, right? We have taken assertive action on, you know, the threat, especially when you see the movement, you see, okay, there was a weaponry, there was a closer. You know, like to the line, like with Palestine, this whole Israel thing, and you know, when situations like that happen, like sometimes when you have, you know, different things are starting to like look like something's gonna happen. But it's kind of a fine line between like containment and like full on preventive, like violent action. So we try with that. Some people are about that all the time, but if you don't attack everybody, you will have no allies, and there's more of everybody else than there are just us,
right?
So, so some people believe in, you know, like might is right. I feel like appeasement is more of the answer. Now, we as the United States tend to have the general viewpoint that we do not negotiate with terrorists, we do not give it to the demands of somebody else, right? Not that we don't negotiate at times, but we typically do not negotiate with terrorists. Like, that's our standard. This may be evident, it just means that that's usually like not the first thing we go to. So we have sort of adopted something all in between, which is deterrence, which is an effort to prevent hostile action or promising to retaliate forcefully against an attack. So even more so than containing, that's definitely like the don't start happening. Be tested, but if you start something, I will be more happy.
Right.
More serious words, right? Like that's like, you know, like the school bully picking on your little brother, little sister,
and you're like, oh,
no, I'm sorry. If you do that again, I'm gonna have to stop you from that. So take it or leave it. But I'm not really wishful, right? That's like the deterrence thing. And we have a very strong, very powerful military that we maintain
that helps back up our words, right?
Like it helps to where people take us seriously when we say we can do this. And we do that with not just people possibly attacking us, but other people who
are weaker,
maybe on the international playground, as it were, maybe don't have as large of a military or smaller entities, like Ireland
or
like something small, you know, then like you said, it's a sort of so that has helped us to ward off a lot of aggression, all aggression. Because I mean, look at
9/11, when I, like, they were not afraid of us, when they came on our school and started us. And just attack us. The World Trade Center had people from all kinds of nationalities in the world. They literally tried to start a war. Luckily, our heads on straight enough as like multiple countries to permit that. I think we could have been close to it though. Just from my personal experiences of going through it, of being old enough to have my where we're being story, but. The fact that we got so many involved, it could have gone years. And great. And I think we have to be considered available. So, we have a lot of that. The Cold War. The period of struggle between the US and the former Soviet Union, lasting from the late 1940s to 1990. During the Cold War, the US and Soviet Union engaged in an arms race to deter the other from attacking. Honest to God, a lot of this to me is so beneath like what we as global community society could and should be focusing on. Sorry guys. Squirrel was a little ADD moment. That's just bigger fish to fry. Not just individual countries, but our global scale, like our economy could be better, like our education system could be better. I'm a huge share of the secret that, the world's like Star Trek. We're not so separate, some of that, But honestly, I feel like until everybody sees aliens and not just a couple of government officials. Maybe more abductions, alien invasions. So they have something all to unify or I'll be interested in or afraid of, whatever.
That may never happen.
But honestly, we could all blow each other off the planet, the amount of nukes that we created during this time frame. For what? It's supposed to, instead of us versus them, why not let's combine our efforts and work together for space and whatever, but I think that's a little too far off. Male world leaders at the time. My husband said, we kind of do the International Space Space Center, but that wasn't what happened.
More on the offensive and that sort of thing. The administration was very, very direct. And the possibility of towards zoning was definitely considered to be but so you don't have to worry about whether or not having issues on the property. So,
Yes. So,
And this one,
So, as well as the and some sort of marketing texture. So
And a lot of groups feel like they need churches and whatever small nonprofits get supplies together and sit off, you know, through whatever the problem is there's a lot of things that are all happening that people haven't been exposed to before. And so if there's not somebody to come along and educate all these things, they don't always know. And so the supervisor told us a story about how they went to. They had received a lot of emails, and some of those were scored. So that sounds great. Except for one and three, there's no one there to teach. They did not know that these helps. If they knew anything, like, or having had surgeries and patients that they had to have talking about,
We are still considering
vaccination. We generally tend to when herds have, we know that we know where we can. Send over here. There was another basically people feel like not only like but not like them, but it also is good PR, and that's how wellness favor internationally by demonstrating our concerns and the press of us. Honestly, this thought process has dominated the reason I guess you could say that, here's the excuse, here's why we need charges to the government. Because I really want to be able to do it. So, the US in general is a party to most international human rights agreements. So our policy is both by us, and by groups that in Congress, right? The president can say, please go ahead, which is what makes the presidency so vital. So the president is also finding the work of all the strategies and also not necessarily by themselves. A lot of diplomatic efforts that we have a lot of differences on and out. So, obviously, Congress plays an important role in business groups, trade associations. Um,
one of these things that people talk about is 9/11 was a response, obviously, to these terror attacks, which everybody's looking to him to do, right? Like, the entire world is looking to him for peace and for next steps. And it's because of his speech at West Point, the president of the policy, the federal action. In what he called disrupting, President Bush was quoted as saying, our security will require all Americans to be ready for preemptive action when necessary to preserve the peace of the end of our lives. And so basically, it's on the idea that the U.S. means if there is threats against the and process and and sometimes that occurs as an executive office of the president, which
So also was at the present. Thank you. And by these civil liberties that were taken away from them, might not impact us that time. It might make sense. Because it's just the right thing to do. We should all always have our rights afforded to us. Relations, how much people are using the policies the president. The book, they were established in Tennessee. And it's one of the original standing committees on the Senate. Overseeing the State Department, other foreign policy agencies, and the State Department of Compliance, as a federal statute. The more valid resolution that Congress has put in place by inviting the president back in of course, that varies a lot from year to year. She just matters at the end of time. service industries, others,
stress, building those connections. If a war, whatever a special family, did they come to volunteer and come to help with it? Stay because of those relationships that are there. What are the other needs? So that representation of that, like the staff are the representatives of that. Right? So if they don't give a good impression, then this program will.
So the UN helps to gather
basically these different countries who have signed up to be a part to make sure that we're on an international level and are prepared to be using action. Get something like what we had during the World War II. So again, there are 193 members, and every member only has a vote, regardless of the size of the country. So if we're issues require 2/3 majority votes from those 193 members, and we also should run sets of purposes. Although it can call extra sessions if we need to, there's something that needs to be handled in there. So the UN Security Council has required decisions that member states are obligated by the Committee for our action. The Security Council can be calling a session at any time, and the representative of each member must be present at UN. The council's proposal of 15 members out of the 195 are permanent. The five major countries on the side, and then once you basically look at it, we take up, we take the experience. in general, like by the general assembly for 2 year terms. The five core members of China, France, Russia, the United Kingdom, and the United States. These are 15 members in the vote, and five of them are required in major matters. These are five members also as a negative vote, like the major, basically. One major is a significant project any substantial proposal. So, that's kind of interesting. The top people and the teachers type of thing. So that's kind of my opinion on that. But it is good that we have something like that here, the civil damages, I guess you could say. And so remember I talked about the policy money in force, right? So we talk about policy. Now we're going to talk about money. So something that was implemented after World War II as well was the International Monetary Fund, which is an institution established in 1924 as well as the facilities international money exchange. So basically I realized that they needed to have that if we were going to move it to international. The World Bank to be able for finances. So after the decision of World War I, the United States was two allies, except for Soviet Union. In 1944, we created the economic structure for the post war world. One major goal is to prevent we basically had an economic collapse, kind of what we did with the Depression. And it basically opened the doors for Nazis in that Holocaust. Germany was at a very weak point in its sector. And so Hitler in this army saw an opportunity. Like there was a window of vulnerability, of fear, anything's going to be better than this. And listen to any of others reported speeches or community of transfers was a phenomenal public speaker and rallying the masses. Obviously, fighting like they were very that a large country of Germany could collapse financially, and they saw the sort of devastation that could cause, and desperate times called the desperate action. And that's what led the way to Hitler being able to pitch in with this thought process. So at the same time, we start showing that the United States made its allies and whatever. Economy and political affairs of developing countries because they could loan money to countries as needed with their economy. And so the economy was like a shock to many political needs as well. So this was called the Bretton Woods Conference, and it was held in New Hampshire. It had resulted in two institutions. So the IMF, which I just mentioned, but more commonly called, right? And it basically was to aid the countries in long term capital investment. And then, the base mission was to help through that, and then the IMF was to provide short
spectrum
flow of money. So we had the IMF and we had the World Bank. And so the World Bank was a long-term like capital building and investing. And then the IMF was a short emergency financing situation. So after the war, the US dollar was sold to means by which the currency of America would be changed into the currency of America. There's the rise in force of IMF increases that are served from some of the emergency debtor nations. The formerly communist that considered the global capitalist economy. Today, IMF loans over $1 trillion. Between 16 and sub-Saharan Africa, where drought and war are so obviously, these were massive issues. I mean, there's definitely a post-world war community that occurred. We just saw all of these things take place. We saw the UN, the International Monetary Fund. Within the United States, you saw the Department of Defense, you saw it in Washington, NSA, you saw a lot of groups form specifically as a result of World War II and then realizing that there were things that didn't happen. And so we took action to that to consume. US alone was $60 billion a year that had to take other countries. That's not like counting the IMF that you know that gives international as well, and that's just less. So remember we've got the care and sick certification. So one time, so giving aid to countries to get money is the positive step that is happening to say, oh my god, let's use this help, what we're gonna need to do. So so most of it's designed to so different actions that the United States wants them to take is the stick, right? Like, okay, you got the carrot. And that's, you know, remember now, this is a negative. Talking like trade embargoes, bans on or on travel to certain other areas, and basically comes to people that are not sympathetic with the United States, as a World Bank or other. So basically, don't do these things. Here's the map. So, sort of, the next section that you're looking for is called energy security, which refers to the development of alliances and agreements among the organizations that play essentially one another and any longer than practices and agreements. And of course, this happened again after World War II. The U.S. Had their first agreement. It's called the Rio Treaty of 47, which created the Organization of American States. It's the model for all future collective security treaties, providing that an arm is acting as a
person would be considered all the American states, including the United States. So it's all by the North Atlantic. Where the United States, Canada, and all West European nations, they'll start using the United States and the European Union as part of the UN. Southeast Asia Treaty Organization. NATO has expanded to fully include communist Eastern European states like the Czech Republic, Hungary, and Poland. The collective security basically started the steps towards what we now know as NATO, which basically is to make sure that the Soviet Union doesn't get stuck there and come back in some form. That is sort of the next largest perceived threat that we would have from Germany if they failed. And so they felt like, after World War II, we had the Cold War, the Soviet Union, this is like 1940s, and so it was created to where they wanted to make sure that there was restricted numbers to make sure they had
So obviously military force, you would come back to that. That is another tool, right? We talked about diplomacy, we talked about military, and now force. Might is right kind of process, right? We have all of these collectives created, all of these alliances are formed across the world to basically try to keep large risk threats at bay at home and I'm trying to think of the best way to put it. Basically making sure that people don't rise up in a way that we can know. The US, one-third of the entire world's military expenditures. That's sufficient, right? Like, that's a lot. It's still considered a last resort, right? We try diplomacy, we try, negotiating, not just jumping straight to that right away. Because it's costly, right? One, all of the things that takes to create, like a war, we're talking battleships, we're talking planes, we're talking about all the technology, and the ammunition and the, just all, everything, right? Everything you can think of that goes with war, not to mention the supplies for the troops, like ammunition, but like food supplies and barracks and all of those things. And more importantly than all of the finance aspects, but the human cost.
Be patient.
The door closed, so I don't wake the baby, and one of the cats has been chilling in here, and he is decided to be done. But we are close to being done, so we are
almost
done.
So, obviously,
With one Asian tribe of people, governments, and other nations. So it includes development aid, cultural diplomacy, student exchange programs, and other mechanisms to shape perceptions. Things like sitting in American actors, I've never seen before athletes in the world. I thought to offer positive unions, encourage it's a branding effort, marketing, public relations tool. When you talk to people about it, the last time I was ever seen was in private school, too much of everything,
for consumers, right? We're consumers of the society. And so I had a couple of people who were having a lot of this in the American flags on every corner. Because when you go to other countries, you don't see that very often, unless it's like at the government headquarters or sometimes, or unless you have a souvenir shop or something. But you just don't see that all over the inside. You don't really see things that, you know, like in everybody's yards and they're on people's cars and they're, you know. And so I thought it was interesting because it never occurred to me that that was like overkill, but it looks like overkill to everybody else that we get it. You're the United States. We need to remind you that you're the United States. So sort of and all the countries that I've visited, like Ireland and Dublin, specifically, have had more Irish flags than like you saw in other countries, which is interesting because, you know, a lot of our background is from Irish, especially in the South. And so so they were definitely the most separate personality and just how they were to us, which I thought was interesting. So, you know, most people had a pretty positive view of us. They just thought we were a little extra. This is a pretty good example of what we're extra. Like, we are, right? Like, I felt people were saying I'm just weird and different in LA. So, the file tool in our tool belt that we focus on is arbitration. So arbitration is referring an international disagreement to their party for resolution. Sometimes seen as a form of soft power. The United States Association for Appeals resolved disputes. So it's like it all depends on like who the leaders at the time, like the references that the Trump administration generally rejected the authority of international. As limitations on American sovereignty because of then Trump was definitely in favor of more of an isolationist country and didn't cooperative, like co-op relationships were not something that he spent a lot of time working towards, as I just said. So, international court of justice is an international So the Department of Defense is very military has a far greater proportion of employment than the general population, but in terms of race and ethnicity, the military is very similar to the United States. Residents of southern states are even more it's just so interesting to take history back to say we were trying to secede from the jail at one point. And then all of the seconds was the loudest was patriotic. I feel like that's not really fair because it might not be patriotic. It's fine to be proud of that. But we're really the loudest demonstration.
So this breaks it down like different athletes. There's a draft that we had. And then, you know, that was in the 70s. Their sons. For example, or in the Korean master policy, environment, all of those things that we put in sort of that text spot sideways. So, China obviously is specifically ever so maintaining the way that it's here. That's not us. And they really have a makes sense. We have no desire to we don't necessarily want them to level power under Russia, you know, Russia, all of them, the time, they maintain the classes that we put in, whether it's just the tax, so they're still very economic, which for us, because it's hard for them to
bearings, finances under control. Russia's current leader, as we all know, established the United States in Europe and as in the middle of their politics, as has been shown to be the case with the investigation of
so obviously, like Russia is a threat and a problem. We know they are very much. They even admitted as much. They tried to interfere with different energy supply outlets and stuff, and trying to European allies depending on Russian energy supplies and engaging in trade with Russia. As a result, Russia would basically put their bearings, not follow different sanctions and stuff when it comes to energy resources. They force support separatist groups into different parts of Ukraine. They're always starting a lot of nonsense, right? They've challenged us in the East, I've meddled in a lot of our trade dealings, and they're just always trying to
Of course, we're always as Saudi Arabia and Israel are coming back to us and our allies and both of them. So we're always concerned about Iran. Something that would have to protect those allies and that sort of thing. Of course, North Korea, they're all very.
UN, you know, has oftentimes said things and boo on you. So, and they've just continued their business. you know, you don't, you're not in the box of me. They're definitely, even though they're not a powerhouse in size, we are definitely some of them. The three specific partnership with a US and a lot of Pacific nations that allow for and trade speaks to them how they are relationship with China. President Trump didn't have a great relationship with China. And that was definitely worse by feelings on the coronavirus. So if you have any Thank you.
other countries. And Terry also focusing a lot on that. So so we try to encourage other destinations to say, as we know, China has one of the problems on the planet. And I actually heard this honor during the pandemic where there were people, you know, trying to just
we're not. And there were people who were saying that it was the first time in their life that they had ever seen clear sky because it was so bad in China. You know, people who pass everywhere they go, it's constant stuff. They don't have any sort of regulations like we do. To combat some of that. And you know, there are people who, because they used to, and then they eliminated it. And so there are people who were born where that's all they ever did. And it was the first time they ever seen it. So hopefully that makes a difference down the road. Like, maybe that they can be some changes in the way that they so your book talks a lot about Jewish being as important as diversity environment, mission of climate change and the other things make sustainable change across the globe. It's an international agreement to study harmful changes in the environment, and then of course the national overall. So we are part of those things initially. Now we did draw on one of those protocols that was very nice. It set limits on emissions of greenhouse gases. We said it will limit harm our economic interests. So at the time of that withdrawal, we were more concerned about the economic side of that decision as opposed to the environmental side. But as there are more and more studies and scientists. If we don't do something, we're in trouble like that on the global scale. This is not just something we were trying to see with the law. You're in trouble like that environment in general. And so more and more people are starting to take that seriously. More countries are really coming together for that. We haven't done our mess together, but there's a great idea that along the sides of these greenhouse gas emissions. So the protocol actually expired in 2012. After the original signers of signing an amendment to review their commitment to resolution, we did not sign an agreement, but in 2015 they agreed to reduce emissions again. So now when Trump was president, he did his first vision and saying that it would cost more jobs to leave the United States. But when Biden became president, one of the first things he did was regulate that. Anybody who should follow the news knows that he's been pushing back quite substantially. He's been
reaching for renewable energy is definitely a staunch supporter of what the scientists were saying. It's bigger than jobs, bigger than the short short effects of the and so the current administration is focusing on these sort of efforts. So there's been a shift in those things. So that is the Indian we definitely heard a lot about the Paris Agreement. So that's all very current information. So that's the book. That's it. So I apologize. The domestic policy and foreign policy videos are longer than the process are. I believe the foreign policy is for 90% of the domestic process. Is any hope? But I know domestic policy. But there's just a lot of this. Now, obviously, what's on the study guide is what you should focus on. The study guide is the portion that you should really make good on. But this lecture helps kind of fill in the gaps a little bit and cover things that you still should know. And I would put it. Questions for domestic policy, and then also for the extra credit, actually at the end of each chapter segment of questions to hopefully guys in the last little bit of this has been much time frustrating with the assisting plasma surgery and the project and just all of that. So here at the end, I know it's been a little bit, so we don't have a lot to worry about for these information that we need to succeed in the exam. There's no base for answering questions. Thank you.